Whenever there is a tragedy, people ask three questions. Where was God? Why did God allow this evil thing? Why does evil befall good people? A hurricane that results in 10,000 deaths. People scream, "Where was God?" A serial killer was caught murdering 37 people. Where was God? A building collapses. Where was God? Jesus already told us these answers. But in order to understand them, we must understand evil as God sees it. Evil can be seen in only two varieties: the evil as God sees it, and the evil as humans see it. We can see the two varieties in distinct contrast by exploring Jesus' statement, "Blessed are ye when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate you from their company and shall reproach you, and cast out your name as evil, for the Son of Man's sake. Rejoice ye in that day, and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven, for in like manner did their fathers unto the prophets." There are three distinct entities in the statement: the Son of Man, you, and men. The Son of Man is Jesus, you refers to the disciples, and the men are everyone else. The men only cast out the disciples as evil due to their relation to Jesus. The disciples are identified with the Son of Man. Thus, there are only two categories here: men and the Son of Man with his disciples. The disciples are not members of the men. We can also find that men means all men except Jesus and his disciples. And we can see this when Jesus said just a few verses later, "Woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophets." Thus, we can conclude that men in Luke 6:22 has the same meaning as all men in 6:26. That means we are left with only two categories: that of all men, or that of the Son of Man and his disciples. Thus, we who are in Jesus face two, and only two, hard alternatives regarding evil: the evil as seen by men, and the evil as seen by God in heaven. God rewards those who have had their names cast out by men as evil. We can help confirm our interpretation by looking at verse 23. We see that their fathers are in the same category as men, whereas the prophets are in the same category as Jesus and his disciples. Their fathers were hostile to the prophets, just like men are hostile to Jesus and his disciples. Jesus said to the Pharisees, "Ye are they which justify yourselves before men, but God knoweth your hearts, for that which is highly esteemed among men is abomination in the sight of God." Jesus made his understanding of evil very clear. From Jesus' point of view, evil contains anything that is exalted among men. Thus, whatever men see as esteemed is actually evil. This does not mean the converse is true. Simply because men classify something as evil doesn't mean that Jesus believes it is a good thing. As an example, both men and Jesus classify the defilement of a child as evil, but for different reasons. What God sees as blessed, men see as evil, and what men see as esteemed, God sees as evil. Some examples of this can be seen pretty easily. A person with a PhD is esteemed pretty highly, but God would classify this as evil. Yet men praise these things, exalt them, esteem them highly, and think of them as good. Nonetheless, Jesus said, "God knoweth your hearts, for that which is highly esteemed among men is abomination in the sight of God." Let us test out Jesus' definition here and make sure it is consistent. We have no use for an inconsistent and therefore illogical prophet. Such a man would make a perfect God false. Jesus himself was, and still is, highly esteemed among men. All over the world, you can find churches dedicated to Jesus. Men spend trillions of dollars in his name for various things. Therefore, by God's view of evil, man's conception of Jesus is evil. Very evil. Jesus cannot be said to be good. And so, what does Jesus say about himself? If he sees himself as good, then he is a false prophet, as he is highly esteemed among men. Jesus says, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone." Jesus does not see himself as good. He sees himself as having, at least in part, evil. Theologians and churchmen will hymn and haw at Jesus' truth with all their might, but they cannot touch its pristine purity and simplicity. They must acknowledge this, or otherwise throw out the truth in preference to what they believe to be evil. For now, this definition of evil for God suffices. We will later give an even more broad definition of evil that explains why this is the case. A definition for what humans see as evil is quite difficult to pin down. Thankfully, every individual person knows what they believe to be evil, and it differs per person, so no one reading this article will be confused. The Islamic fundamentalist believes America to be evil. Americans, likewise, perceive those fundamentalists to be evil. Both parties have profound and rational reasons to believe their positions, but both are only thinking in relative terms, relative to them. Had the other been born and raised in their enemy's ways, they would likely not think of themselves as evil. Thus, the evil of man shifts and changes from person to person. Man's definition of evil is a relative evil. We can define man's view of evil as that which is harmful, hurtful, or bad for their group. A rape of a child is clearly evil. The death of our family is clearly evil. Excessive taxes is clearly evil. We can take this even further. Should a man drive while drunk and therefore have his license taken away, then the state did evil unto him, since it caused harm to him and his family. This is still evil, despite the fact that the state acted justly. The very worst evil to men is the one that kills them. Men believe there is no coming back from death, yet they ask the same questions when they believe they see evil. Where was God? Why did God allow this evil thing? Why does evil befall good people? We can see easily the relativity of the evil of men. The Muslims responsible for 9/11 did not see the destruction of the towers as evil. America, however, absolutely saw it as evil. All this evil is relative. In God's view, both the response to 9/11 and 9/11 itself were evil, as both are highly esteemed by men. Everything that men esteems is evil, and there is none good but God alone. So why is there evil? Jesus also explained this. He said, as one of his central principles, "For whosoever shall save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it." In this great principle, we find the basis for God's definition of evil. Recall that Jesus only spoke what God told him to. Therefore, we can conclude that God hates life in this world, and that life in this world is an absolute evil. How can this be? Because God grants eternal life only to those who hate life in this world. The person who loves this life does it in opposition to God, who is the only good being. Life in this world is itself an object of love, an absolute evil. God then hates life in this world because we humans must hate this life in order to inherit his eternal life. Obtaining eternal life alone is God's will for humanity, and for that to happen, we must hate our current lives. If we loved it, then how could we love God, who is not here? Thus, all men are evil because they love life. The thing that man exalts the most is life. Doctors and hospitals are abound to save life. Wars are decried to prevent the death of life. Pain and suffering is evil because it lowers the quality of life. Therefore, all men view a threat to life as evil. The instigators of such are therefore seen as a perpetrator of great evil. Likewise, those that prevent death or who help raise the quality of life are seen as great beings of good and are highly esteemed. This view is in direct contrast with the will of God, who wants people to hate life and seek him so that they may obtain eternal life. Recall, it is not the people that do great works that get into heaven, nor is it the people that have great faith in Jesus Christ that are resurrected. Jesus said, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven." And the will of God is solely concerned with the resurrection. Jesus said, "And this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day." If you don't have a will which looks forward to eternal life at the cost of everything in this life, then it doesn't matter what you've done or what you've believed in, because you are not doing the will of God, and therefore you are evil. That is why Jesus calls those who he casts out workers of iniquity. Once again, all men are evil because they love life in direct opposition to God, who is the only good being. That they love life leaves them blind to the absolute standard of God. That is why men cannot find answers to questions such as, where was God? Why did God allow this evil thing? Why does evil befall good people? The very thing that establishes their evil nature is the thing that they wish to justify. They see the love of life as the epitome of righteousness. They cannot understand that only death will allow disciples to be resurrected to God. Loving this life means loving life without God. God, our Creator, does not want us to love this life without Him. It's as simple as that. From humanity's point of view, Jesus makes incredibly binding, stringent demands on His disciples. As he does so, He says the reason for compliance is so that we may be children of God. The motive for doing these things, peacemaking and loving our enemies, is so that we may be children of our Father, which is in heaven. Thus, Jesus even said, "And call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your Father, which is in heaven." Since Jesus spoke only that which God gave him, these are the words of God. It is God who commands His children to call no one else their father on earth. We can only have one Father. God, who is in heaven, wants to be that one. Therefore, only those children of God could possibly be candidates for heaven, as God alone is good. But life in this world keeps us away from God, and the devotion to life, family, community, and the nations of this world is keeping us away from God because He has mandated a choice and given us the freedom, the experience, and the knowledge to make it. We can either choose this world and this life, or we can choose God. Therefore, whatever binds us to this world, which does not contain God, is evil. The love of this life binds us to this world more than anything. Then comes the love of family, community, and nation. These loves are absolutely evil, and all men are committed to them, contrary to the will and purpose of God who is in heaven. Thus, all men are evil, absolutely evil, except for the disciples of Jesus, who alone follow the will of God. Now we can understand why Jesus said, "If ye were of the world would love his own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you." The ultimate purpose for humanity is to become God's children in resurrection. That alone is the good purpose for humanity. As far as humans are concerned, that is the only absolute good. Anything contrary to this is evil. All those earthly attachments to mom, to books, to movies, to jobs, to marriages, to nation, all of those are absolute evils. So, where was God? Simple. God is the Father, which is in heaven. God was in heaven during every war, during every rape, during every death. He always has been and always will be. He is not here in the middle of the evil that is the life-loving world of humanity. That is absolute evil, and He hates it as humans love it. In the parable of the prodigal son, the father only thought of his son as dead while the son was away in the far country. Certainly, his son could have cured cancer in that far country, but to the father, the son was not listening to his will, and therefore was as good as dead. Why did God allow this evil thing? Simple. God has given all people the freedom to make choices, and that freedom is essential to His will. He wants His children to have the freedom to choose Him as their only Father. Therefore, He does not interfere with whatever evil deeds men choose to perform. Why does evil befall good people? The question is misconceived. There are no good people, not even Jesus. Jesus said, "No one is good but God alone. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that ye may be children of your Father which is in heaven. For He maketh His sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust." This is perhaps the most powerful anti-discrimination statement ever made. God's divine laws of nature treat everyone the same, straight and gay, man and woman, rich and poor, good and evil, just and unjust. They all experience the same laws of nature. We see this in action in Jesus' time as well. John records, "And as Jesus passed by, he saw a man which was blind from his birth, and his disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, Neither hath this man sinned, nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. Further down chapter 9, we find, If this man were not of God, he could do nothing. They answered and said unto him, Thou wast altogether born in sin, and dost thou teach us? And they cast him out. Both the disciples of Jesus and the Jews believed that the man was born because of some sin, either his own or the parents. But no, God interferes neither to bless or to curse. For this man, there is some physiological reason the man was born blind. God does not discriminate, not even on the basis of morality, to correct a condition or to cause it. Jesus, who intended to heal the man by a miracle, gave a reason for it. Jesus answered, Neither hath this man sinned, nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. There were present at that season some that told him of the Galileans, whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And Jesus answering said unto them, Suppose ye that these Galileans were sinners above all the Galileans, because they suffered such things? I tell you, nay, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Are those 18, upon whom the Ptolemy and Siloam fell and slew them, think ye that they were sinners above all men that dwelt in Jerusalem? I tell you, nay, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Disasters happen, both by human design, such as wars, or from natural causes, like earthquakes and floods. The moral state of the victims is always irrelevant. The threat Jesus said to the Jews, Unless you repent, you will all likewise perish, does not imply that God would destroy the city due to their evil ways. Jesus simply foresaw that if they kept on their rebellious course, the Romans would take care of it. He was not threatening divine retribution. Let us look at this verse again. We can rewrite this verse to make it relevant to our modern times by paraphrasing it and saying, Or those 3,000, upon whom the Twin Towers in Manhattan fell and slew them, think ye that they were sinners above all men that dwelt in New York? The answer is again, I tell you, nay. But except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Some people believe that simply because people are victims of disaster, that they will go straight to heaven. Jesus, nor any prophets, ever said anything like this. Jesus gave us the great principle, which is, He that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. So the question isn't how people died, it's whether they were loving life and trying to save it when they died.